€33, please.
33.
I don't have a lot of change, so I'm not sure what.
Now we are in the wall guard's quarters. The openings in the tower wall are loopholes and embrasures. The double embrasures to the right of the chimney is something else. From here, the guards could keep an eye out on the starting and ending points of the drawbridge. This open air corridor is known as an open sentry walk. You can see the town of Muiden and the Vecht River and the gaps between the battlements. Maryland's called embrasures. You could aim accurately with a bow and arrow because of the narrow embrasures. These also provided safety and protection when keeping watch or from outside attacks. The herald or king of arms was an important person during the Middle Ages. He was an expert on coat of arms. Banners bearing the arms of Floris V, the nobleman who had the Maudeslord built, are hanging on the wall. The stone walls in this room are medieval and date back to about 1500. The narrowly tapered recess inside the wall is an embrasure that could accommodate a handheld cannon. This roofed-in sentry walk was reconstructed in the 19th century with a new covering. Traces of the original roof can still be seen on the walls. The old roof was lower and steeper, and there were no battlements here. These were built in the 19th century because of their romantic appearance. You can clearly see here that brand new bricks were used on the interior. This tower housed the living quarters of the writer and poet P.C. Hooft. He wrote large sections of his Dutch histories here at Maudeslot Castle. He had a view of the former Zuider Zee from here. He could also admire the gardens through the windows, which he had installed on the former outer fortifications in front of the castle. This western tower is the oldest and highest tower in Muiderslot. This room is named after Floris V, the legendary count who commissioned the construction of this castle in 1285. He chose a strategic spot by the river Vecht, close to the Zuider Zee. Those who intended to sail on the river first had to pay a toll. He also commissioned the construction of roads and dikes, which was an important boost for trade. Farmers and citizens became richer and more powerful, and they looked upon Floris as their hero. Whenever he visited the Muiderslot, he could count on a grand feast in the Knights Hall. A cozy place in a cold castle. In this room, that was especially for ladies of the castle, there would be a burning fireplace. There's a reason why this room is called the cabinet. It derived from Camera Caminata, a heated room. In the Middle Ages, This room was probably decorated in a colorful style with carpets, tapestries or wall paintings. The sandstone barriers in the fireplace are unique. For already 500 years, those two figures have been staring out into this room. Here muskets, halberds and other weaponry are all at your fingertips. When the enemy was spotted, they quickly had to get armed. It is still uncertain as to whatever the weapons were actually kept in this room. We are now underneath the high steep roof of the private home. In the event of an attack, the producing wooden beams would be extended. By placing a beam transversely over these transoms, a high scaffold was created, a temporary additional route during defense operations. The curved wooden beams in the roof constructions are unique. These curves were custom made by forcing young trees to grow in a curve or by manipulating tree trunks with heat.
Thank you.
If you love a good party, this is the place to be. In this gorgeous night hall, the lord of the castle would receive his most important guest in style, such as Pieter Cornelis Hooft, who lived in the Muiderslot for a period of 38 years in the 17th century. This writer and poet organized numerous literary evenings for his friends in here. Two centuries later, this group of friends were also called the Muider Circle. This hall was a place of allure, but also one of sternness. This is where the lord of the castle acted as a judge. The payment table, with its stone tabletop, is reminiscent of that time. Fines were paid with the help of a table like this. The sound of the coins on the tabletop proved whether the coins were real or fake. Pasties, eel soup, or oxtail stew. The chefs in this kitchen prepare the most delicious meals. The large hearth is at the center of all activities. This is where the kettle was hanging above the fire, or a peasant roast on the spit. They didn't have to do many of their groceries at the market in Amsterdam, because the Muiderslot was largely self-sufficient. Vegetables, fruit, and herbs were grown in the castle gardens. Fish was caught in the Zuider Zee, and game was also hunted. The larger baking and roasting activities took place in another bakery and a second kitchen downstairs. When there were no guests, this dining room was used for having meals. It was very easy to refill the beer or wine jug. With the hoist to the left of the hearth, they could lower the jug to the storage room below. The big windows with window sills were made in the 17th century to create more light into the room. There used to be only embrasures in the wall. Two of those are still visible today. Those holes became useless after the invention of gunpowder and the arrival of modern weapons and defense techniques. In this living room and bedroom, Pieter Cornelis Hooft went through both good and bad times. He was only 28 years old when he moved to the Muiderslot in 1609. He experienced great sorrow when his first four children and then his wife Christina van Erp died. After three dark years, he found happiness again with Helenora Hellemans. They both loved having friends over and organized all kinds of receptions at the castle. Especially in the plume season, in the summertime, the friends knew exactly how to get to the Muiderslot. Visitors can still taste plumes for the garden every first Sunday of September. front attic. The wall opposite the tower passage is the old fire of the original building. The 19th century stepped cable of the large hall wing rests on this thick wall. At some locations, the loft is kept uncovered and the ridge of the roof is visible. The 19th century structure illustrates what a traditional Dutch medieval wooden roof looked like. In the Middle Ages, the attic served as a storage area to stow away extra household goods and weaponry. Additionally, the attic was often used as a space for drying laundry. For those who ended up in this dungeon, the future which lay ahead was not so bright. If they hadn't already confessed, the torture rack, thumb screws or a red hot poker would usually get it out of them. The verdict was not much fun either. It was often a so-called mirror punishment. A thief would lose their hand and a spy their eye. Escaping from this dark old dungeon was nearly impossible. Even the convention, the toilet, was therefore built within the walls. The castle was the perfect prison. It was just as difficult to get in to as it was to get out. In the 7th century, a famous inhabitant of the Muiderslot, the writer and poet P.C. Hooft, had beautiful gardens and orchards planned. The gardens provided both food and beauty, and a beautiful garden enchanted the castle owner's status. The gardens were planned in the Dutch classicism style with its rectangular shapes and pure symmetry. Walk through it yourself and discover 17th century vegetable herbs and flowers.